brothers and sisters, this is simple a question. We visit with a partner. Social distance, we just keep this. So if you find a place where there's a white, don't sit there. Just sit there.
stuff.
Thank you.
and sisters, good morning and welcome to this service I'll be conducting over this meeting. And to the George Munene, who is taking this time, presiding over this meeting. I'll just start by making some housekeeping. Number one, we are striving our best to abide with the government rules, you know, when it comes to COVID. So we highly encourage that we observe them again. And the washrooms are on the corridors towards both the gents and the ladies. And you go and they're on the other side of the building. So feel free to use them. We also just again emphasize COVID care. Just stay apart. You are needed. And we want to appreciate all of you for coming here today. And we appreciate the family for giving us the opportunity to have this service today. We'll start this meeting today by singing and accompanying him, Oh My Father. Sister Marlene, who has been invited to your college today, and the screening will be our piano. Following the opening hymn, Sister Judith Mburi is invited to be our, give us the opening prayer. And then I'll come back to the rest of the program.
Thank you. Father in heaven, we are extremely grateful to you for our beloved friend, mother, sister, wife, Mabel Moroni Mark. We love her and are thankful for the memories she has given us, the experiences we shared with her, and the lessons she taught us. We ask you to comfort her family members, in particular her husband and children. Fill the gap that has been left in their hearts with peace that surpasses all understanding. We also pray for those who will be taking part in this service. May your spirit fill them, and may your blessings be upon us all. I say this believing and trusting in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, beloved sisters, for the red light and the offering exercise. We just want again to echo that as we congregate here today, we just maintain the COVID regulations. We just sitting. We ask that these have been arranged and indicated by the presence of them. We also want to make a mention that we, many of us are watching online, and we acknowledge them as they participate, and we're streaming this service in a brief YouTube channel. Most of our members are watching it from home. We will have the following moving forward now as the speakers. First of all, we start with the family. We invite Sister Annie and Ellen, who will give their tribute and their speech. They'll be followed by Sister Kimberly Mark, who will then address us, and then Brother Kennedy, who will address us. And then he will also refer us the theology of the service of the Sunday book. Brother Mark, Tim Mark, Sister Mabel's husband. And then we invite Brother Joy Muruli, who will give the word of thanks. And that's the order that we'll follow. When all is done, Sister Consolata Usi will sing a special song. Just a song. And we'll bear testimony. Then I'll come up the rest of
First of all, I would like to thank everyone here today and watching online. My mum loved the church and the sense of solidarity and peace it gave to her. I think I can speak for my sisters when I say we will keep our tribute short and sweet, as it's been very difficult to accept our mother's passing. But we want to show our love and admiration for our mother, as she was truly one of a kind. For everyone that knew my mother knew she was a character, and would often joke that I was her acting last born. But I am grateful to be her youngest child, as not only did she shower me with love and affection, but gave me two older sisters and an older brother who have extended themselves to be the extra parents I need at this difficult time. Although my mother has been taken from me early in this life, her teachings, lessons, and memories will forever stay with me. My mom had an energy unmatched. She was courageous and headstrong, with a caring soul and lovable person. My mother taught me the true meaning of unconditional love. She gave me so much without expecting much in return. I will greatly miss her. Nonetheless, I will look out for the signs that she's with me in spirit. I will always love you, Mom. In this life and beyond, you are in my thoughts always. I would like to share this scripture that has brought me comfort during this difficult time, and hope it can bring peace to others too. So with you now is your time of grief, but I will see you again and you will rejoice, and no one will take away your joy. Until we meet again, love you dearly, Annie.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. I just wanted to say, I am forever grateful to be the daughter of such a mighty woman. Although our time together has been cut short, I wouldn't trade her for anyone else, and I would do it all the same. Her generosity and deep care has inspired me and countless others. The death of a larger-than-life individual like my mom didn't make sense at first, but now I truly believe that her personality was too large for this life, and so she has transcended onto the next and may finally rest. I can't wait to see her again, but until then, I will continue to talk to her in my heart. Thank you.
Thank you. So I just want to make some few remarks directly to Auntie on behalf of myself, my sister Wendy, Sue, and my mother, Fortunata. Auntie, thank you so much for showing us what an ambitious, driven woman full of life looks like. Thank you for inspiring us to work hard. Thank you for the gift of our wonderful cousins. We will make you proud. With love, Angela, Wendy, and Sue. And on behalf of my mother, she would want you to know that she found you to be an extremely industrious and hardworking woman. A loving sister-in-law, friend, daughter, and mother ready to help family and anyone in need. And I wish to extend the prayers of my mum or her siblings to all of you today. Rest in eternal peace, Auntie. Thank you.
Morning, brothers and sisters. I also just want to speak shortly. One thing that I always wear, something that she'd love to wear things that were shouting. She called them shouting colours. She loved to wear outfits that really popped. And during this time, it's really made me realise that it was a reflection of her personality. She was bright. She was positive. She always knew how to lift my spirits up when I was down. Even when I was maybe sad about something small, she made sure that she knew that she cared and she wanted me to be happy. She wanted everyone around her to be happy. I just wish that I could have a portion of her brightness and her happiness. I know that lives on with me and through my sisters as well. The other thing I just wanted to share is that she did not just tell me that I could do anything, she led by example. She showed me that not to only lift yourself up, but to lift everyone around you. And I think I can see that here while we've been traveling and we come back here to her home in Kenya, I can see that she has lifted so many other people up with her. I'm just grateful for my mother. She was one of the greatest examples I have of a good person. I'm so grateful for her faith and how strong she was because she made me strong. I love you, Mum. I hold you very close in my heart, and I hope she recognizes that she has done so much good for her family and for her friends. And I say these words in the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
I wanted to say something, but I couldn't. I'm just reading it. Memo was born. 23rd view. My mother was born on June 23rd, 1962, to the late Mheshimiwa Timothy Muruli and the late Madam Clara Muruli of Isuka East Ilebo, Mission Shinyalo. Constituency in Kakamega. She was the fourth born child in a family of six, five girls and one boy. Mebo was brought up in a Christian family of friends, church, and a devoted member of the Jesus Christ of Greater Saints. Education. She attended Shibuya Primary Boarding School, from where she proceeded to Primosi Girls High School for her all levels. Then she joined the Shanzu Teachers College for training as a teacher, a level she successfully accomplished. She was then posted to Kikambala Primary School, where she taught for about 10 years before leaving for the UK in 1990. Work. Shortly after settling in the UK, she pursued her education in children matters and soon started working with the government on foster care for asylum-seeking children in the UK. She came up with Kimberley Group Housing for the children put under her care a job she did well with all her heart and strength. The company did well, and she became an envy of many in a foreign land. With her impressive work, David Blanket assisted her to secure government contracts to offer services in the whole country of the United Kingdom, including Manchester, among others. As the business grew, she got a mortgage to buy houses in the major cities of UK, such by the year 2000, her property portfolio was in excess of 70 houses in the UK with more than 4,000 clients. Marriage. While in the UK, she met her husband Timma in church, and they got married and continued serving together. The Lord blessed them with 4 children, Kennedy, Kimberly, Elena, Annie, and who are now all adults. Politics. As time went by, Mabel got interested in politics. Back home, she worked closely with the Wiper Democratic Party leader, Kalonzo Musyoka, and other leaders, Muskari Kombo and Bungoma Senator Moses Wetangula. It is this interaction that contributed Kibaki's party national, Mwai Kibaki's point person and campaigner in the UK during the 2007 general election. She returned home to contest for the Kakamega gubernatorial seat as an independent candidate in 2013, but lost to Honorable Oparaga. A second attempt in 2017 saw her join the Jubilee team, but still she lost to Honorable Oparaga. She was appointed by the Jubilee government to the Wasanyiro Board Authority as a board member, and that has kept her working between Kenya and London. Sickness. Mabel spent most of her last days at the front line fighting the COVID-19 pandemic, only to be brought down by it. She exploited her wide global networks to mobilize support to combat the pandemic in various parts of the country. Diagnosed with heart condition, she fell ill on Saturday, October 24th, and was rushed to Nairobi Hospital, where she tested positive of a virus she had waged a serious battle against. Mabel passed on 30th, 2020, while being transferred from Karen Hospital, Nairobi, to Kenyatta University Teaching Referral and Research Hospital, where she was pronounced dead in arrival. And my final words, thank you all for coming and supporting us at this critical hour. Mom, wherever you are, we love you so much. You are an amazing woman.
First of all, say thank you to everybody, both church and company, for putting up this memorial service for Megan. Thank you from the top of my heart. And next, Meg, we're in London. We married in 1994 and had 3 wonderful daughters, Kimberly, Elena, and Dan. If I ask you all to now close your eyes shut and picture in your mind Megan, I know that you, all of you, are seeing Megan with a huge bright smile. I know no one who can smile so beautiful Megan. And Megan, you will see Megan passing to you a large plate of food. She loved being a host, You cannot enter Mabel's home without leaving afterwards with your belly full. She would always see that you had a drink and were comfortable. Mabel loved comedy. Her favorite comedy was an English television series called Keeping Up Appearances, with her favorite character being Mrs. Butler. Try and watch it soon and have a laugh with Mabel. Mabel loved a good crime film, and her favorite was Columbo with the LA detective. Mabel loved music and singing. One of her favorite songs to sing along to was Search for the Hero by Play It Next Time You Are Listening to Music. A few lines of the song that Mabel loved to put to you've got to search for the hero inside yourself. Search for the secret you hide. Search for the hero until you find the key to your life. In this life, long and hard though it may seem, live it as you live a dream, aim so high. Mabel loved to sing this song. Mabel is a great mother. She cared so well for our children, so well that other mothers would come to see Mabel all of the time for advice and caring for their children. Mabel was always busy helping. She wanted to help people because she loved people. Mabel would not only give someone in need their last shilling, Mabel would also give someone in need her very last hour. Mabel was a person who always sought greater heart. She had a desire to achieve the best she could, whether it be to improve her career or further her education. What mother she could be to Kennedy and her girls. Mabel had this desire to achieve not for herself, but to enable her to lift others up to a higher place with her. Mabel loved God, and Mabel would say to me, if you want to show that you love God, first love and serve the people. That is the way to show your love for God. She wanted, Mabel loved, and during her years spent in London, England, she never forgot home. Kenya is her home. She wanted to serve the people of Kenya. She was always thankful. During those years in London, I'm so glad that she and Kennedy spent much time together when she returned to Kenya. She would talk to me about her siblings, George, Christine, George, Helen, and Janet. She talked about her parents, Timothy and Clara. She loves her mother, Clara, very much. Kennedy, when she was in London, she missed you so much. But she worked, and she wanted you to have the best education possible, which would help you through your life. So she worked hard and long to pay for Kennedy's school fees. She loved that Miss Kennedy grew up in London. All the stories of her childhood and home near Leo, Chinyali. She told me about her experiences attending Jansen Teacher Training College. Although she was the youngest there, she left in high school. And then she became a primary school teacher. Was she there? Mabel's state is so very important to her. She loves to tell everyone about her faith. She was a great missionary for our saving people. She loves to read the scriptures, sing the hymns of the church. She my heart. Two of her favorite hymns are, "O My Father, the Spirit of God." When children were all small, she would tell them the Bible story. Let's stop singing the church hymn. Mabel loves church, and Mabel loves her family. But also she had eyes to see a bigger picture. For she could see that happiness and industry. The community in which her family and children dwelt needed to be a place in which people having an industry also. And that is why Mabel would step outside of family and church and get involved in the community. If the community is a good and safe place, family homes and church congregations would also be good and safe. We love you, Mabel, and we miss you. I know that she is now forced in God's army on the other side of the veil. I love you, Mabel. I say this word in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Most sincerely for having made the time to be here for my sister's service. I don't want to talk much about Mabel. I think you've heard it from my brother-in-law. All I can do at this point in time is just to thank the church and specifically Mobe and Bishop Bernard for hosting us here today and for all the support that you've given us as a family and as a community since this tragedy befell us. I want to thank the doctors, the four hospitals that Mabel went through before she met her death, for all the work that they did on her in an effort to save her life. I want to thank most sincerely the organizing committee who came in the hour of need and try to do everything possible to ensure that we give my sister a warm send-off. I want to thank my office, particularly my CS, Amatiangi, my PSK Bishop, for all the support that they've given the family, even before Mabel died, because they are aware, and my colleagues in the office mobilized themselves and made there would have been a big task for us to be simple. I want to thank the political class for all the support that they have given, and I think most of you who are there witnessed it last night when we had a small fundraising event for Mabel. I want to thank all friends and relatives for both the emotional and financial support that you've given to us. I really thank my brother-in-law, Timothy Ma, who has taken care of my nieces while Mabel was in Kenya here. and actually who has been a very invaluable support to the entire family. And lastly, I would like to thank Nebo, my kid sister, who has actually been the pillar of the family and beyond. Her generosity, her love for humanity, her love for God will be remembered through eternity. Rest in peace, my kid sister Nebo. Thank you.
She served well as a sister of Zion, full of humility and ready to work with everyone, regardless of the status of life. We will miss you, my loving sister. Rest in peace. Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, we are grateful for what you heard from the family. Thank you so much for your tribute to this domain. We want to get in this. We will now head to our speakers today, and our first speaker today will be Sister Evelyn Jepkinney. She will be followed by Darius Morgan, second class of the state presidency. Then I'll speak, then President Kumbulani will let you address us. Following President Kumbulani, we'll all stand and sing him 100, Nearer My God. Stay.
Brothers and sisters, often you and I sometimes will be given an honor that we don't deserve. And this honor today befalls me to speak about Sister Mabel, whom I worked with in public affairs. You see, I knew Mabel for a short 3 years. Before then, Brother Mobe had talked about her many times to me. And when I met her, she was everything that Brother Mobe had said about her. Mobe joined the Public Affairs Council, which is now called the Communications Council, at a time when we were trying to figure out how to move the church out of obscurity. And she was a worthy addition to us because she had ideas and she had courage that probably some of us did not have. And she helped us, those of us in the council, to be able to magnify our colleagues. She was a wonderful sister. I can regale you about stories that we shared, about Mrs. Bucket, about farming, about motherhood, and about food, and about our home in Kakamega. She always called me her sister-in-law because my husband comes from where she was born. Mabel was about helping people. Even though I know her for a short time, I know she served from the front. She wasn't shy about looking for solutions. She was a very active member of Renew Society. And as I said, I was privileged to serve with her in the Public Affairs Council. We loved her very much. And in these two organizations of the church, I saw her faith in action. Mabel was about service and about relieving others' pain. She wanted the best for everyone. She went out of her way. Sometimes we would have budget constraints with what we were doing in public affairs, and she would go out of her way to fill up the gap because she wanted the best for all around her. She served the Savior in a way that was an example to all of us. And I hope someday I can be just a little bit of what Mabel was. She loved her family. I met her daughters today, this morning. I feel like I've known them forever. I have seen their pictures, I've heard their stories, because Mabel always talked about them. And when she didn't speak about her daughters, she talked about mine. And she teased Joseph, my son-in-law, who was also part of the council, that he had to step up and be better than both of us because we were older. The disease came hard and fast. we didn't have time to say goodbye. She slipped away from us quietly, and it hurts. You know, the disease won the battle, but Mabel won the victory. You see, she was a temple worshiper, and we all know that for the covenants we've made in the temple, families can be together forever. And she knew that when this tabernacle of clay is destroyed, she has a habitation in eternity. And she's teaching me today that absence from the body is presence in eternity. And with the Lord, for those of us who have made covenants, to obey and strive to be better, we may shed tears here today. Savior also shed tears for his friends. He shed a tear for Lazarus. And we shed tears today for Mabel, not because we don't have hope, but because it hurts that she's gone. We weep because parting is hard. Mabel was a friend, and I have wept a lot. I have asked myself so many questions, why it had to be her. But our Father in heaven knows why it had to be her. I just want to say that I learned several things from Mabel, but I want to highlight just three of the things that I learned from her. Number one is that you can always smile. She smiled through life. You know, it's interesting, Mabel was a politician. And for those of you who know about politics here in Kenya, it's all about attacking the other person. Mabel was in the opposite sides with my father-in-law, Kalwale, and she always had kind things to say about him. I found that very interesting. She always had a smile, even when he teased her that you don't have a seat here in Kakamega, go back to where you've married. She always smiled. And so she taught me that a smile brightens your day, but it also helps others to remove pain that is brought about by the kind of conflicts that sometimes are in the field of politics. She smiled through her life immortality. The second thing that she taught me was, don't complain, find a solution. Her daughters have said that she was larger than life. Indeed, I was able to have the privilege to work with her and see how larger than life she was. Mabel never said, we can't do this. She was always about, what again are we planning to do? Let's do it. And she would actually, I was so privileged that sometimes she would take the lead to do some of the activities that we would have in the council. I never had her whine or complain, defeated. She always looked for solutions with a can-do attitude. Third thing that I learned is that all things are possible. That even as a politician, she was still able to be a faithful member of the church. She always pushed me. I remember the last time that I was with her physically. We had gone to Kapsabet to deliver relief to Nandi County. And we were in the same car, and we talked about COVID and schools opening. Those of you who know me, I'm in education. And I spoke to her, and I said that, you know, I gave her ideas of what I thought need to happen before schools open. And she pulled out the phone and called her brother George and said, I want you to meet the CS. I want you to share the ideas that you have with the CS, because I think you have something that you can contribute to this country. She was always about creating opportunities for people. She talked about farming. She talked about what she was doing in Narok. And she had promised that when COVID is done, she would take me and show me some of the farming that she's doing in Narok. Probably won't be able to do that with her. But she taught me something, that you can be a mother, you can be so many things at the same time. She was such a wonderful person. To all of us today, I want to recite the words of an old hymn. There is a balm in Gilead that makes the wounded whole. And I really hope that even as our hearts are hurting today, that we might find that balm of Gilead to apply to our hearts, that we may find comfort to know that Mabel is in a better place. Brother Timothy has said that she was a missionary. It always pleased me to see how her face brightened when she talked about the church, when she talked about her faith, and when she introduced us, members of the council, to senior people in government. Sometimes I feel discouraged and think my work, but Mabel will come and say, we can do this together. And she brings that spirit that revives our souls again. I just want to share a scripture before I conclude. From the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, verse 54, and I'll read up to 56, it says, so when this corruptible shall have put on incorruptible and put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin. The strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, I'm just here to bear my testimony that I know that God lives. And I know that Sister Mabel, even though she's gone before us, soon and very soon, we'll be able to meet with her and be able to rejoice with her and look back at the fruits of some of the work that we have done. She has gone to continue the work that she did here, and it is up to us. It is our responsibility to continue to magnify our callings, to be able to reach out to those that are needy in society, and to be able to relieve pain. I have lost a sister, but I'm grateful that I hear her voice, I see her smile, and she encourages me to keep striving. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Sisters, I'm grateful for the opportunity and the honor that has been bestowed upon me today to speak in this memorial service of Sister Mabel Mark. I called her mom, and this goes back to 2002. When I first met Mabel in London, in England, as a young missionary of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, my first area was in Enfield Ward, which is in the Watford stake, which is the same stake that Mabel's ward, Wembley, belonged to. So after serving in Enfield, I was transferred to Wembley, and it was my first Sunday at church after the transfers. And here comes this lady with a big, bright smile, forgetting that I'm a missionary and attempting to give me a hug. Of course, I did this and moved aside, and she introduced herself and she told me she's from Kenya, and that was the beginning of our friendship. And as our children have spoken at this juncture to Kennedy, Kimberly, Eleanor, and Annie, please accept our deepest sympathies. You're not the only ones who have lost a mother. We all have, and we all loved Mama Mabel. And to George, Helen, Janet, and the rest of the siblings, please accept our sincere condolences. And you are in our prayers as a family. We pray that Heavenly Father may grant you strength so that you may bear the loss and the fortitude that will carry you through as you, with the circumstances that you find yourselves in with the loss of Mama Mabel. As it has been said, Mabel had a big heart. She served and helped everyone who came her way. And I saw this as a young missionary and the subsequent visits that I made to London after my mission. She was constantly helping people, taking in children who perhaps didn't have anywhere to go in the UK, immigrant children, and providing food, shelter, and clothing for them. So one day I asked her, this is after my mission, probably 5-6 years after my mission, I was in London and I met with her, we were having lunch. I asked her, why do you do this? And she said, we cannot claim to love the Savior whom we've never seen if we can't love our fellow brothers and sisters who are around us. To me, she epitomized a true Latter-day Saint, a lady of faith and courage. When I wanted to start my first business, I called her. I told her, Mama, I think I want to try my hand in business. What is the advice that you can give me? And she said, well, I'm not going to tell you much, but two things. It looks quite attractive when you look from the outside, but I assure you, it is very difficult. The advice that I would like to give you is, no matter how difficult you decided to go into it, never give up. That is the Mabel that I knew. Somebody who was always optimistic, full of hope, and who always encouraged me to seek for the best in me. When I served as a young missionary, I received the most member referrals from Sister Mabel. And I was in Wembley ward for quite a while. I think I served for 9 months in the same ward. And she always was available to come out and teach with us. And as Brother Tim Mark said, she always fed us. And because of her, I got into trouble with my mission president a few times. Because we'd go to Sister Mabel's house, there was so much fun, full of happiness and joy in the house, and we'd forget ourselves and we'd go back home late. And we wouldn't report on time. And one day, she got a phone call from my mission president, who loved Sister Mabel dearly because she was a super member who gave referrals to all the missionaries who served in Wembley. And she got a little bit of attention. Kimberly knows, and Eleanor, the voice of my mission president, and what he said to Sister Mabel. But all in all, she was a wonderful person. She was a leader. She inspired women. When I met her when she went into politics, I met her always with women who looked up to her. And she was an inspiration to many. And to also some of us, her success in business truly, truly, truly inspired some of us and gave us the desire to venture into business. And I always sought advice. As a church, we know of the plan of our Father in heaven, the plan of salvation, as we call it. And as part and parcel of the plan of salvation, we know that we are born, we go through this mortal journey with all the challenges that life presents to us, and eventually, at the end of it all, due to sickness, as it is Mama Mabel's case, accident, or old age, we will all die. and each and every one of us, we have that appointed time when it comes, we will answer the call and go to meet our Maker. And that is what has happened to Sister Mabel. However, we take courage in the atonement of the Savior Jesus Christ. Because Christ, the only begotten Son of our Father in heaven, came to earth. And upon the cross at Calvary, he died and was buried in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea and resurrected after 3 days. We all shall be resurrected. And that is what gives me hope. We will miss Mama Mabel for a moment, but a time will come when we will be reunited with her, especially members of our family. And as Sister Evelyn spoke, Mabel was a temple worshiper. And she had the privilege and the opportunity to be sealed to our family. And that gives our family hope that they will be reunited with her. Because Christ died and resurrected, we all have the hope of resurrection. In the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 6 and verse 14, it says, "And God hath both raised up the Lord, and will also raise us up by his own power." Because of the resurrection of the Savior Jesus Christ, Sister Mabel will be resurrected through the power of God. As we know, those of us that are members of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the gift of resurrection is a free gift. Because Christ died and resurrected, each of us inherited that gift. And we all shall be resurrected when that time comes. And in 2 Corinthians, chapter 9, chapter 2, rather, verse 9 to 10, we read, "But we have the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God, which raised the dead, who delivered us from so great a death, and that deliver in whom we trust that he will yet deliver us." I know without a shadow of a doubt that Sister Mabel had faith and trust in her Heavenly Father and the atonement of the Savior Jesus Christ, and as a result qualifies for the gift of the resurrection. And in the book of Revelation, chapter 20 and verse 6, it says, "Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such the second death hath no power, but they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years. Now, those of us who are members of the church know what is the qualification that we have to meet to qualify to be resurrected in the first resurrection. I would like to believe that Sister Mabel met that particular qualification, and that she will be among the first who will answer to the trump of God and be resurrected when that time comes. And in conclusion, I would like to read the scripture that my dear elder Sister Evelyn shared with us, and this is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And I'll read from verse 15 to around 58. It says, "Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, we shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. And verse 55, O death, where is thy sting? O grave,